Okay, so good morning everyone. Today we are going to continue with our book club on the fundamentals of diagnostic radiology on the chapter of skeletal trauma, that's chapter 42. Will be presented by our colleague Dr. Emidia. May she start.
Good morning, dear teacher Dr. Ahmed and colleagues. We start with spine. Usually a cross table lateral view of the cervical spine is obtained first to avoid unduly moving the patient who might have a cervical fracture. If the lateral cervical spine appears normal, the remainder of the cervical spine series, including flexion and extension views, if the patient can cooperate, is obtained. When you look for the cervical spine, it's important to visualize all 7 cervical vertebrae. If not visualized, repeat the film with lowering of the shoulder. As in this case, obvious, 5 cervical vertebrae appear in the film. After repetition of the film, the dislocation of C5 over C6 appear, which was missed in the previous film. Second important point, assessment of Linus to see any discontinuity which may indicate serious traumatic injury. First line, soft tissue line from the posterior border of the airway down should be smooth and uninterrupted. This area, prevertebral soft tissue, should be several millimeters from till C3 or C4. From C4 downward should not be more than the width of the vertebral body. Second line, from the anterior border of the vertebral body, also this line should be smooth and continuous, not interrupted. If there is any interruption, indicate serious traumatic injury. Third line, second line, but from the posterior border of the vertebral body. Also, this line should be smooth and uninterrupted. Fourth line, from the junction of the posterior lamina with the spinous process called spinolaminar line. The spinal cord lies between line 3 and line 4. All these lines should be smooth and uninterrupted. If there is interruption in these lines, indicate a serious traumatic injury. Fifth step, inspect this area, C1 and C2 area, a little more closely to see the distance between the posterior border of anterior arch of atlas and the anterior border of the dens. Normally, up to 2.5 millimeter in adult and 5 millimeter in children. If more than this value, indicate suspicious of transverse ligament injury, which connected these two structures. Here, normal. In this case, widen it. Indicate disruption of the transverse ligament which connected these two structures. Third point, in the cervical spine, look for the disc spaces to see any narrowing or widening. Jefferson fracture, a blow to the top of the head, such as when an object falls directly on the apex of the skull, can cause lateral masses of C1 to slide apart, splitting the bony ring of the C1. This is a bony ring. It is not fractured in one side. Fractured in more than one side. In diagnosing a Jefferson fracture on plain film, the lateral mass of C1, as here you see, fracture, the lateral mass displaced laterally, extend beyond the margin of the C2 body. So I see fracture at the dens, at the base of the dens.
When you have all the vertebrae are rings.
Yes. Okay. Fracture in more than one side.
You cannot fracture a ring
in one side. Yes.
You cannot. You have to fracture at two sides.
Yes. Two or more.
At least. Two.
At least, yes. At least, okay. Yes.
Just like the pelvis.
Yes.
The pelvis is a ring, the body pelvis. You cannot have a displaced fracture one side. Doesn't mean. Must mean. Okay.
Well, here at CT scan, it's obvious fracture here at three sites. Just being asymmetry of the space on either side of the dens. Normally, the space on either side of the dens is equal. Just think asymmetry of the spaces on either side of the dents is not enough to make the diagnosis. This can be normally asymmetrical when rotation or with rotatory fixation of the atlantoaxial joint. Like in this case, as I said, the distance, this distance should be equal on both sides. If unequal, called rotatory fixation of the atlantoaxial joint. The atlantoaxial joint becomes fixed and the C1, C2 bodies move in massy instead of rotating on one another and move together.
Yes.
It is easily diagnosed with open mouth odontoid view. In the normal odontoid view of the space, lateral to the dentis are equal, should be equal, these two spaces. With the rotation of the head to the left, the space on the left side become wideness. With the rotation to the right, the space on the right side become wideness.
However, here, yes, the space on the right side is not wider. It's narrowed on both. So this indicates fixation.
Yes. Rarely it is.
When you rotate the head to the right, the space on the right becomes wide. High normal. To the left, the space on the left becomes wide. If you rotate to the left with the space not wider,
fixation,
it's not moving
separately. Rarely it is associated with disruption of the transverse ligament of C1 C2, which is diagnosed by increase of more than 2.5 mm in the space between the anterior arch of C1 and the dentis. However, when it is then a serious problem. It is usually present spontaneously or after a very mild trauma, such as unusual sleeping position.
شايف مرة تنام على مخدة مثلا متغيرة تقعد الصبح وقفتك كلها متشنجة وما تقدر تتحرك. It's fixed. All is wrong itself, but yeah, it's the cause.
Another fracture, clay shoveler fracture.
Clay shoveler.
Clay shoveler fracture.
Which
is a fracture of C6 or C7 spinous process. Here, the importance of seeing all seven cervical vertebrae in the plain film to see whether fracture is seen or not. And all seven, yes.
Yes. You are at the middle spinous process, thickest.
Although it's more commonly seen in C6 and C7 spinous process, but can be seen in any lower cervical spinous processes. Another fracture, Hagman fracture, which is unstable, serious fracture of the upper cervical spine that is caused by hyperextension and destruction, such as hitting one's head on a dashboard. This is a fracture of the posterior elementis of the C2, unusual displacement of the C2 body anterior to the C3. Here, fracture is clear, but here it's way subtle. But if you draw a line, spinolaminar line, you see this is not meeting the line normally. Yes, interrupted. They often escape neurologic impairment because of the fractured posterior elementis of C2 that, in effect, causes a decompression and takes pressure the injured area. Flexion teardrop fracture, severe flexion of the cervical spine, can cause a disruption of the posterior ligaments with anterior compression of a vertebral body. It is usually associated with spinal cord injury, often from the posterior portion of the vertebral body being displaced into the central canal. Yet if you draw a line through the posterior body of the vertebra, the line is disrupted. Posterior displacement of this vertebra with anterior wedging and small avulsion fracture. Unilateral locket facet, severe flexion associated with some rotation can result in rupture of the apophyseal joint ligamentous and facet joint dislocation. This can result in locking of the facet in an overriding position that in effect causes some stabilization to protect it against further injury. It occasionally occurs bilaterally. Here you see.
You know here, the facet joints of the vertebra are like that.
Yes.
Okay. In high vertebral body, facet joints like that. So sometimes it's severe flexion, one of them will lock like that. Okay? Yani usually it's like that, normally. Severe flexion, it will yani displace. Yes. Facet joint, e.g., yukfur. Okay?
3 3 4 قفل ستوب سو يونيلاترال. This is an injury, but at the same time this will protect the movement that might cause further injury. يعني هذا الديسلوكيشن اللي الوقت هو protection against further injury. يعني هذا لو يتحرك يجوز شال سواء مشاكل اكبر.
Here you see the widening of the disc space between C6 and C7 with posterior displacement of C7 vertebral body and locket facet. Seat belt injury is seen secondary to hyperflexion at the waist. This causes destruction of the posterior elements and ligaments, and anterior compression of the vertebral body. It usually involves T12, L1 or L2 level. A fracture of the posterior body is called Smith fracture. If the fracture involves the spinous process called trans fracture, but although horizontal fracture of the lamina, pedicle and transverse process also occur. Here you see the anterior wedging of the vertebra. Also, here you see the fracture also seen in the involving the pedicle transverse fracture.
All the recent literature, they advise against using names for fracture. يعني لا تقول trans fracture, clay shoulder fracture, Jefferson fracture. لا, describe it. Fracture of
the posterior body.
أنت تعرف شنو trans fracture؟ أنا مش معرف. تكتب لي there is trans fracture Manchester body. إذا أنا ما أعرف. You have to describe it. ماكو كوليز وسميث وما أدري شنو تشارلز وجيفرسون وهاندمان. A lot of names no one can remember. So you describe it.
Posterior body Smith. If involved the spinous process, trans fracture. But posterior body, Smith.
I think our classification here, if it's involved first just spinous process, if it involves posterior body, but then it's different from this one.
Spondylolysis is a break or defect in the pars interarticularis portion of the lamina. On oblique views, the posterior elements form the figure of Scotty Doc. The cause is variable, some say congenital or post-traumatic. Just seen on oblique view, this is the transverse process which forms the nose, the dog. This is the pars, the pedicle which forms the eye. This is the superior articular facet which forms the ear of the dog. This is inferior articular facet forms the front leg. This is the pars interarticularis between the two facets. This here, the defect here in the pars. If it is bilateral, the defect bilateral causes forward slip of the vertebra above on the vertebra below, called spondylolisthesis. Four grades.
Either anterolisthesis
or four grades. If less than 25% grade 1, between 25 to 50% grade 2. If between 50 to 75% grade 4, more than 75 grade 3, more than 75% grade 4. This is okay only if defect involve both pars bilaterally. Anterior wedge compression fracture of the spine are commonly seen, especially at the thoracolumbar junction, due to an old injury, but it is difficult to say whether it is old or acute radiographically, even if degenerative changes are seen. Here you see the anterior compression of the vertebral body. It is important because if it is acute and left unprotected, a wedge compression fracture can proceed to delayed further collapse with resulting severe neurological deficit, like here. This is called Kummel disease and typically occur 1 to 2 weeks after the initial trauma. And if this acute and left unprotected, become progress and the patient can result in paraplegia and serious problem. As in this case, the second image and become more compressed and the patient get paraplegia. Another important thing in patients with ankylosing spondylitis, fusion of the spine, and to lesser extent with DISH, have a high risk of fracture. Even if patient have ankylosing spondylitis with history of trauma, but negative plain film, almost always mandatory to do CT scan for the patient. Here you see subtle compression of the L1, but at CT scan, the fracture clearly seen. And in every patient with ankylosing spondylitis, with history of trauma and pain, with negative plain film, do CT scan for the patient. About hand and wrist, this is Bennett fracture involving the base of the face metacarpal, base of the thumb. But if the fracture extending to the joint called Bennett fracture, if not extending to the joint like that, called pseudo-Bennett fracture. Almost always require internal fixation. Another fracture like Bennett but communicated fracture, also involving the base of the thumb with extension to the
Bennett
joint.
Fracture is a cheap fracture that
yes.
extends to the articular surface.
So yes, to the joint.
The trick is that it extends to the articular surface. It must be internal if
yes.
it's marahil. Okay, it will cause problems. The muscles attached there will pull and will prevent healing. Rolando fracture,
community,
can sometimes be managed conservatively. Rolando, my name is community.
Yes.
That is not community, but that is surgical.
As I said, if the fracture involving the base of the thumb but not extending to the articular surface called pseudo-Bennett fracture. Mallet finger or baseball finger is an avulsion injury at the base of the distal phalanx. This is distal phalanx. This is avulsion fracture which extends the rigidorum tendon insertus. Yes. If not corrected, permanently become
flexion.
Yes.
Because
flexion.
If that extends the rupture, finger will be like that. You cannot
yes,
extend.
You cannot extend the finger.
The finger is on the film, but he cannot extend it actively.
And become flexed permanently if not corrected. Another fracture, gamekeeper thumb, is an avulsion of the ulnar aspect of the face metacarpophalangeal joint on the ulnar side where the ulnar collateral ligament inserts here. This is face metacarpal, this is proximal phalanx at the base of the proximal phalanx on the ulnar aspect. Lunate and perilunate dislocation. Before I talk about it, you must know the normal AP and lateral wrist. Normally in the AP, the lunate has rhomboid shape. On the lateral, lunate cup-shaped and the capitate sits on the lunate. This is normal, AP and lateral. This occurs when the ligaments between the capitate and lunate are disrupted, allowing the capitate to dislocate from the cup-shaped articulation of the lunate. This is best seen on lateral views. Lunate-perilunate dislocation can be diagnosed on IP views of the wrist by noting a triangular or pie-shaped lunate. Ordinarily, the lunate, as I said, has a rhomboid shape in IP view. This is normal lateral. This is lunate, cup-shaped, and the capitate articulate with it. But if perilunate dislocation, if you draw a line from the radius and passing through the lunate, but capitate and other surrounding bones lying dorsally to this line, this is called perilunate dislocation. If you draw a line passing through the radius and capitate, but the lunate dislocate volarly, called lunate dislocation.
So normally you have the line passes through
all three.
Yes. Capitate, lunate, radius. That's the normal. Bilateral view. If you draw a line, and it's lunate, B. It's the lunate, but not the rest. When I'm perilunate dislocation, everything is dislocated posterior.
Yes.
Okay. In the atelasma, everything distally. Lunate is not in the line. Then this is a lunate dislocation. كل شيء مكان بس lunate طالع من مكان. Try to imagine it. Okay.
This is perilunate dislocation. If you draw a line here, pass through the radius and lunate. But the capitate and the other bones locate dorsally. Dislocate dorsally.
So everything is dislocated?
Dorsally.
Dorsally.
This is lunate dislocation. If you draw a line here, pass through the radius and capitate, but the lunate dislocate volarly. In AP view, as I said, normally rhomboid shape. Yes. Here become triangular shaped in AP view.
Pie.
Pie shaped.
Pie,
triangular
pie.
This is important because if not repaired, cause permanent injury of the median nerve. Hook of the hamate fracture, one of the most difficult wrist fracture to identify radiologically. The best view to identify hook of the hamate fracture is carpal tunnel view. This is normal hook of hamate.
45 degrees. 45.
Here you see a fracture of the hamate, plain X-ray. In CT scan, this one normal, this hamate, but this is sclerosis is seen.
Have the CT scan always see the sclerosis, not the fracture line.
Yes,
yeah,
yes.
So it's not that
this is healed
fracture
right now.
Huh? Healed. Healed fracture. Healed, maybe, yes. Oh, chronic stress fracture with no fracture line, just reactive sclerosis.
Rotatory subluxation of the navicular, okay, when the patient. Yes, scaphoid, طبعا navicular.
This is navicular.
Occur after fall on outstretched hands. This result is from rupture of the scaphoid lunate ligament, which allows the scaphoid to rotate dorsally. On an IP wrist plane film, a space is seen between the navicular and the lunate, where ordinarily they are closely opposed, called teriothoma sign.
هذا كوميديان واحد
British famous actor. Yes.
مشهور بأنه عنده
كابيتون. This is normal, normal one. The space should be less than 3 millimeters. This is yes. This is rotator subluxation. Yes.
طبعا نفس توماس نفس ديفيد ليترمان ساين.
Yes.
هم واحد كوميديان ديفيد ليترمان مشهور يعني هم عنده space between the tongue. The same sign. أي واحد عنده space between the tongue.
Sign.
Navicular fracture is important if the plain film is negative, mostly negative. We can repeat the plain film after 1 week or get immediate MRI. It shows low signal.
Usually for outstretched hand, we'll fracture the scaphoid or
yes.
Navicular one of saying. Mm. With X-ray, sometimes you see it, sometimes, most of the times you don't see it.
Yes.
فإذا you have pain
in the snuff box.
Snuff box اللي هو تعرفون هذا
yes.
It's suggestive of
fracture.
Scaphoid fracture عندك واحد من اثنين إما stabilize it حط box lock repeat after 2 weeks looking for a fracture line a sclerosis whatever or you just shift to MRI
but
to see the fracture of the bone marrow
but it's better
it's
to get MRI if a vascular necrosis of the navicular develops, it is the proximal fragment that undergo necrosis because of the blood supply. The navicular bone begins dorsally and run proximally, like here. Start dorsally and come proximally. And if there is fracture here, the proximal fragment become
necrosis. Fracture
as in this case, you see the fracture at the waist, the proximal fragment become
sclerosis.
At first it become dense, then fragmentation and collapse. Kinbock Malacia, a vascular necrosis of the lunate.
Yes,
can you see? It has a high association with a discrepancy between the length of the radius and the ulna, as seen at the radiocarpal joint. If the ulna is shorter than the radius, termed negative ulnar variance. If the ulna is longer than the radius, it's termed positive ulnar variance. And there is an increased incidence of the triangular fibrocartilage tear. And if negative ulnar variance, increased incidence of Kinbock Malacia. If positive, incidence of, yes. As you see here, the lunate become dense and collapsed. This is normally, IP, if you draw a line here, should be like that. But here you see the ulna shorter than the radius, called negative ulnar variance, increase in incidence of Kinbock Malacia. If longer than radius, called positive ulnar variance, and increase incidence of triangular fibrocartilage tear. It's normal one. Tricuspid fracture is it is best seen on a lateral femur, which shows a small chip of bone off the dorsum of the wrist. This is virtual pathognomonic of avulsion of the tricuspid. Only seen on lateral, not seen in IP film. Corys fracture is a fracture of the distal radius and ulna after a fall on outstretched arm with dorsal angulation. If fracture of the distal radius associated with dorsal angulation, called corys. If volarly displaced, called Smith fracture. Yes. As you see here,
what the fracture originally described by Corys was both. The Corys, whatever, both and both. But then we should call the fracture more radius, some more Corys. So on with ulna or without.
Yes.
Okay?
You see here the fracture displaced dorsally, but here clearly seen, volarly displaced. Another important subject, plastic bone deformity of the forearm. Occur after trauma, no clear fracture is seen, but cause anterior bowing of the forearm bones. But it is important because if not corrected, the treatment is by breaking the bone and resetting it. If not, reduce supination and pronation of the hand. Yes. As you see here, cause anterior bowing of the radius is seen. It's clear. Montigia fracture is a fracture of the ulna with a dislocation of the proximal radius. It is important in every case of trauma to get two views at 90 degrees to each other. You see here fracture of the ulna. If you look, if you just look this image, you cannot see the dislocation of the radial. It is very important because if not diagnosed and treated, get a vascular necrosis of the radial head. Ulna and radial head dislocation. Galeazzi fracture is a fracture of the radius with dislocation of the distal radio ulnar joint. Dislocation of the ulna. Another important subject, sometimes you will not see the fracture clearly. Just seeing the displacement of the fat pad. Normally, we see the anterior fat pad in normal lateral elbow joint, but triangular shape it, like here. This normal fat pad anteriorly. But posteriorly not seen because of the auricular fossa is deep. Mm-hmm. In case of trauma, posterior fat pad in a patient with history of trauma indicate underlying fracture. But not. But the cause is not always trauma. In the setting of trauma, indicate underlying fracture. But if the patient have arthritis, infection, also the posterior fat pad may also displace it. Also the anterior fat pad, as I said, normally triangular shaped, just anterior to the distal diaphysis of the humerus. But in cases of joint effusion and underlying fracture, become displaced. As it becomes superior and outward, called sales sign. If you see posterior fat pad, it is important to take other serious films, either oblique, CT scan, tomogram, or MRI. As in this case, in lateral film, the fracture is not seen, but in oblique view, you see subtle fracture of the humeral radial head. In adult patient with closed epiphysis and the history of trauma, visualization of posterior fat pad almost always indicate fracture of the radial head. But in children, supracondylar fracture, yes.
يعني فات بار بالتشيلدرن
سوبراكوندايلر
بالادلت راديال هيد ان كيسز اوف
تروما يس تروماس
اذا ماكو تروماس اني ثينج ذات كوز جوينت ديفيوجن هذا فراكتس انفكشن وات ايفر اوكي
بس نورمال شولدر ايبي شولدر نورمالي ذا جلينويد اند هيومرال هيد شود اوفرلاب فورمينج هاف مون ساين ان ذس لوكيشن This is anterior dislocation. You notice the humeral head displaced inferiorly and medially to the glenoid. In posterior dislocation, this half moon sign is lost. There's a distance here, a gap between the glenoid and the humeral head. Also, this is normal. This is posterior dislocation. Another view to diagnose the shoulder dislocation called transthoracic or transcapular view. It's normal take the technique like that.
Just imagine someone with shoulder dislocation. You tell him stop, stand
yes,
like that.
Yes.
He will not be able to move his hand yet. So it's just theoretical rather than.
The coracoid and acromion and glenoid form Y-shaped. Normally, as here, the humeral head overlies the glenoid. If anteriorly dislocated, called anterior dislocation. If posterior to the glenoid, called posterior dislocation. Another important subject is pseudo dislocation of the shoulder, يعني neutral dislocation. As you see here, you see the humeral head dislocated inferiorly and laterally, not like anterior dislocation, inferiorly and medially. The cause is hemoarthrosis in the joint. But if you look at the transcapular view, you see the normal relation of the humeral head with the glenoid. But faint lucency here seen, causing the bleeding to the joint and dislocation of the humeral head. If the fracture is faint or subtle visible on the plain film, always get CT scan. Here the fracture is faintly seen. But if you do CT scan, you see the detail of the fracture, like this case, extending to the articular surface. In pelvis, fracture of the pelvis, and especially those involving the stabulum, can be difficult to evaluate completely with plain film alone. CT scan should be considered in almost all acetabular fractures because of the possibility of the free fragments and subtle fractures that plain films do not show. As here, shows superior displacement of the femoral head, but here fracture is not clearly visible. But in CT scan, show comminuted fracture of the stabula. Especially in elderly patient, if the patient, elderly patient comes
think of hip
even negative plain film. Yes. Sacral fracture occur in half of the cases that have pelvic fractures that can be difficult to see on even the best films because of the sacrum is often hidden by bowel gas. In looking at the sacral fracture, one should examine that arcoid linus. This is normal sacrum. You see arcoid linus here. But in this case, the arcoid linus on the right side become disrupted, not like the left side. This indicates sacral fracture. Sacral stress fracture is also called insufficiency fracture. Osteoporotic or previous radiation therapy is a risk factor for sacral stress fracture. Patchy or linear sclerosis on the sacral ala that may or may not show cortical disruption on the plain film. Here you see subtle sclerosis, but in this CT scan, cortical disruption is clearly seen. These should be differentiated from metastatic disease because of their characteristic location, appearance, and history of prior radiation and bypassing a cortical break. In metastasis, there is expansion, there is no cortical break. CT will usually but not always demonstrate cortical disruption. Sacral insufficiency fracture on radionuclide bone scan, if bilateral, show Honda sign, if bilateral. On MRI, see as a low, diffuse low signal.
On
sacral, on T1, yes, coronal, yes, T1.
You know, edema.
Yes.
Okay.
Just seen in bilateral, with bilateral stress fracture. Before talking about avulsion fractures, you must know the insertion of the muscles. These are common sites of avulsion fracture. Here you see avulsion, you see the cortical disruption and periostitis at the sacrum. This is the site of avulsion, yes, ischial tuberosity, which hamstring attaches. Also another, this is avulsion fracture of the anterior inferior iliac spine. Yes, rectus femoris. Osteoarthritis, three features seen in degenerative joint disease, sclerosis, joint space narrowing, and osteophytes. But in four joints, erosion may be seen, temporomandibular, acromioclavicular, symphysis pubis, and sacroiliac joints. Here, as you've seen, erosion, sclerosis, at the symphysis pubis. Also here in the sacroiliac joint, you see sclerosis and erosion, which may be mistaken for ankylosing spondylitis. But here you see in osteoarthritis, you see osteophyte, but in ankylosing spondylitis, not. The dense sclerosis seen here, in CT scan, bridging osteophyte seen bilaterally. In case of ankylosing spondylitis, as I said, osteophyte is not seen. About leg, femoral neck stress fractures is the most serious, unfortunately, one of the rarest. Rarely these progress to complete fractures that with continued weight bearing can be displaced. And it's important. If not treated, can result in complete fracture. As here you see, linear sclerosis in the distal part of the neck. Also stress fracture occurring in the distal diaphysis of the femur in proximal, middle, and distal third of the tibia. Sclerosis in a weight-bearing bone that has a horizontal or oblique linear pattern should be considered a stress fracture until proven otherwise. As you see here, sclerosis and faint luciency, this is stress fracture of the femoral neck. Here in the tibia, you see sclerosis. If not treated, proceed to complete fracture. A stress fracture occasionally will appear somewhat aggressive, with aggressive periostitis and no definite linearity to the sclerosis. As here you see periosteal reaction and sclerosis, you must be mistaken for aggressive lesion and undergo biopsy. If a clinical presentation unusual for a stress fracture and the plain films are not diagnostic, take an additional film 1 or 2 weeks later. CT and sometimes will better delineate the lesion. As here MRI is better. Coronal T1 weighted image show low signal metastasis along the fracture site. Another site for stress fracture is the calcaneum. It's important. Here seen as a linear sclerosis in the calcaneum. Hip fractures in the elderly population can be very difficult to detect. A negative plain film in an elderly patient with hip pain after trauma, even relatively minor trauma, does not exclude a femoral neck fracture, as I said previously. Here, the fracture is very subtle, but the patient discharged it, and after 2 weeks return it with a clear fracture at the femoral neck. MRI has been shown to be very useful in demonstrating the femoral neck fracture that are occult. As here, very subtle in plain X-ray, but in this image, coronal T1 weight image, you see the linear low signal intensity along the fracture site. Another fracture, tibial plateau fracture, can be difficult to exclude on rotten plain film. in cross lateral film, you see fat fruit level. But here the fracture is seen clearly. Like elbow. Lisfranc fracture is a fracture dislocation of the tarsal metatarsalis. It is commonly seen as a neurotrophic or Charcot joint. This is normal plain extra foot. Normally, the medial border of the second metatarsal should align with the medial border of the second cuneiform. If not, means Lisfranc fracture. Calcaneal fracture, this is normal calcaneum. If you draw a line from the anterior process with the posterior process, this angle should be normally 20 to 40 degree. If less than 20 as here, indicate fracture.
Bohler angle.
Bohler angle, yes. Normal 20 to 40. If less than 20, means fracture. It's compressed, yes. As here. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Excellent, very good. Very nice presentation. Any questions?